right, Acts chapter 17, beginning in verse 22. What do Christians believe about God? This is Paul's very famous sermon on Mars Hill. Acts 17, verse 22. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship. I find that the Athenians are a lot like Americans today, very spiritual, but not very specific. And this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth. He doesn't live in temples built by human hands, and he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he marked out their appointed times in history and set the boundaries of their lands." Do you know that God planned it specifically for you to be alive at this time in the human history and to be right here? I'm thankful that the Lord chose the United States of America for my boundaries, aren't you? God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. I love those words. "For in him we live and move and have our being, as some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill." Beloved, we have to get this through our heads. We are made in God's image. He is not made in our image. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising Jesus from the dead. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, "We want to hear more on this subject." But some people became followers and believed. That's the group that we want to be in, the group that believe and become followers. Amen? Let's pray and invite the Holy Spirit to minister to us this morning. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you so much for your presence with us. Thank you for your powerful word. Your word is truth. Father, I pray that you'd give us the ability this morning to receive. Father, give us understanding, comprehending minds, open hearts, open our spiritual ears and spiritual eyes so that we can receive with humility the word of God, which is able to save our souls. If your heart agrees with that, would you say amen and amen? So we're talking about the transformed Christian mind right now. Our starting place was Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. Paul tells us there that if we're going to follow Jesus and please God with our life, a mental metamorphosis is required. Paul says, do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but rather be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That word transformed is the word metamorphosis. It describes the transformation of a tadpole into a bullfrog or a caterpillar into a butterfly, so that when you see that beautiful, colorful creature take flight, you can't believe that it came from that creepy, crawly thing on the branch. And that's the kind of radical transformation that our thinking needs as followers of Jesus. You see, Paul tells us in these verses that there is an antithesis between the thinking of secular society and Christians. The priorities of secular society are not Christian priorities. The morals and values of secular society are not Christian morals and values. In fact, Paul says they sharply conflict. So where do we get this transformed Christian mind? Well, Jesus said that a transformed mind must begin with a transformed heart. In Matthew 15:15, Jesus said, out of the heart comes evil thoughts. In other words, the problem with your head is your heart. Beloved, listen, no matter how hard we might try, it is impossible to teach someone to think like a Christian if he hasn't surrendered his heart to Christ. No matter how much we try to explain this, it just won't make sense. Paul wrote that the carnal mind is unable to receive the things of God because they are spiritually understood. He said that the god of this world, Satan, has blinded the minds of unbelievers. If someone hasn't surrendered her heart to Christ, no matter how hard we try to teach her to think like a Christian, it won't sink in, it won't stick. But when someone has had a heart transformation, Christian thinking comes almost automatically. A Christ-transformed heart leads to a Christ transformed mind. A Christ-filled heart leads to a Christ-centered mind. And then our mind continues to be renewed by feeding on the Word of God, the Bible. We talked a lot about the Bible last week. Jesus said, "Now you are clean through the Word that I have spoken to you." He prayed for us, "Father, sanctify your people through your truth, set them apart, cleanse them, make them holy through your truth. Your word is truth." For the next couple, 3 weeks, I want us to share about a Christian worldview. How do we, as followers of Jesus, see our world in light of our faith in Christ? How do we see ourselves? How do we see others in light of everything the Bible teaches? How do we think about non-Christians and especially anti-Christians? How do we think about human history? How do we think about human governments and authorities? Extremely pertinent questions right now. And if you'll permit me, I want to move systematically from the familiar to perhaps the unfamiliar. The reason being, what is familiar to many of us is new to some of us. And sometimes it's good to re-familiarize ourselves with some things that have gotten a little foggy, amen? Last week we shared about what Christians believe about the Bible. Today I want to talk about what do Christians believe about God. One day a little girl in Sunday school was drawing furiously with her crayon. The teacher was amazed to see her intensity, so she went over and asked her, "Sweetheart, what are you drawing?" The little girl said, "I'm drawing a picture of God." The teacher said, "But honey, no one knows what God looks like." And the little girl said, "Well, they will when I'm done." No one can launch an investigation to know what God looks like, but God has done us a favor. He has drawn a picture of himself in the Bible, in the scriptures. Today we only have time for a quick peek at the drawing God has made of himself, but I want to take a quick look at 12 things that Christians believe about God. Now, don't have a heart attack. We do have another service that's starting at 11:30. We'll make it, all right? By the grace of God, if you believe in miracles, you better start praying. We're going to talk quick about 12 things that Christians believe about God. Number one, God is eternal. Do you know that is one of the most mind-blowing things that we can say? It falls in that category of things the Bible calls things too wonderful. Even if you believe that you'll live forever, you know that you had a beginning. But when we say God is eternal, we mean that he had no beginning and he will have no end. There was never a time when God did not exist, and there will never be a time in the future when he will not exist. In the Bible, God calls himself, "I am." David said, "Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God." As Christians, we believe that God stands outside of time and space, and he actually created time and space. So the concept we have of God in the Bible is a God that has always existed. He is uncreated. No one made God. He always was, and he made everything that is. He's the ever-living one who never changes and cannot be changed. 12 things that Christians believe about God. God is eternal. Number two, God is a spirit. God does not have a body. We cannot make an image of him. You might remember in the Ten Commandments, God forbade his people to ever make an image of God. You see, God is so much higher and greater than we can imagine that if we could imagine him, he wouldn't be God. We can't make a portrait of him that can do him justice. We can't make a temple that could possibly contain him. Isaiah says, "Heaven is my throne, earth is my footstool. Where is the house that you will build me? Where is the place of my rest?" Jesus said, God is a spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. To worship God in spirit means that I worship him from an inner connection with him. To worship him in truth means that I worship God from my understanding of who he is that I've derived from the scripture and my time with him. There are times, of course, that we do speak of God in human terms, but we shouldn't take that to mean that God is like us. We speak about the hand of the Lord. We speak about the eyes of the Lord. These are just ways of speaking that help us to understand the activity of God. When we talk about finding shelter under his wings, it doesn't mean that God is a giant bird. Doesn't mean that he has angel wings. It's poetic language that expresses a truth about God's activity in a way that we can wrap our minds around it. 12 things Christians believe about God. God is eternal. God is a spirit. Number three, God is a person. When we say God is a spirit, we don't mean that he is a force or a current of electricity. He is not yang to the devil's yin. He is not like the force in Star Wars that can be manipulated for either good or evil. New Age religion, among others, believes this. What are the qualities of personhood? Intellect, a will, the ability to express emotions, and the capacity to reason. And God is a person that has all of these qualities. He has the most incredible intellect. He has his own will and intensely passionate emotions. Paul said, "Who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has become his counselor?" 12 things that Christians believe about God. God is eternal. God is a spirit. God is a person. And number four, God is omniscient. That means that God is all-knowing. Have you ever known someone who thinks he's a know-it-all? Yes. Well, God really is a know-it-all. He knows everything there is to be known. He has all knowledge. He knows everything that's happening and everything that has ever happened. God can do what you're glad your friends cannot do, and that is read your mind. In fact, David said, "He knows my thoughts before I even think them." How amazing is that? Hebrews says, "And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account." When you reflect on that a little bit, the omniscience of God is something that's actually incredibly comforting. For one thing, it means that God knows everything about me, and yet he still loves me. Our founding pastor's wife, Patty Tate, has a little sign on her kitchen windowsill in New Jersey. I'm going to steal it one of these days when I go down to visit. It says, "Jesus knows me, this I love." Beloved, nothing about you is secret from God. Jesus said, "God knows the very number of hairs on your head, and he knows whether you're going to keep it or not." Jesus said that God knows exactly what you need even before you do. You know, we all know that line in the Lord's Prayer, "Give us this day our daily bread." In the original text, the line actually reads, "Give us today the bread of tomorrow." And in other words, "Father, would you please lay the groundwork today so that I can receive tomorrow the things I'm going to need that I don't even know yet I'm going to need." God's omniscience also means that nothing ever catches God by surprise. Beloved, listen, God is not ever moved by the morning headlines. God is not surprised by what appears in his social media feed. Tweets don't send God into a Twitter. His throne is established forever, and his is an unshakable kingdom. God's omniscience also means that he has wisdom. He knows exactly how to help me, and he can guide me in what to do. Job said he knows the exact path I'm traveling. He knows exactly where I am on the road of life. What an amazing, profound thought that is. When I travel to Asia, sometimes traveling through some massive, massive population centers, and there are just literally millions and millions of people stacked on one another, I look around and it is just astounding to me to think that the God that we serve and the God that we worship and love is big enough to know each and every one of them and to know the most intimate details about them. He knows where I'm at on the road of life. He knows the exact challenges I'm facing right now. He knows the major decisions that I'm weighing out in my heart and mind right now. He knows the opportunities that are in front of me. He knows the way that I take. And when he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold. James says, if any of you need wisdom, ask God and believe, and God will give generous portions. And he won't chide you for the asking. You know, sometimes we think if we've messed up in life that we can't go back to God and ask for wisdom to get out of this mess. But that's not what the Bible says. The world says to us, you made your bed, now lie in it. Jesus says, get up and take up your bed and get walking again. 12 things that Christians believe about God. God is eternal. He's a spirit. He's a person. He's omniscient. And he is omnipresent. That means God is everywhere. He's consciously aware of everything that's taking place throughout the universe and whatever lies beyond. That's how Jesus could say, not even a sparrow falls to the ground, but your heavenly Father sees it and cares. Isn't that an amazing thought? Did you ever have a day when you wonder, God, do you really see? God, do you really know what's happening? God, do you really care? Jesus said, not even a sparrow falls to the ground, but your Father sees it and he cares, and you are much more valuable to him than many sparrows. He's able to be anywhere, and in fact, he is everywhere all at once. How does God do that? I don't know. David wrote, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I'm going through hell, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and I travel to the farthest corner of the globe, even there, your hand shall lead me. Your hand shall hold me. What a promise that is. Now, that doesn't mean that God is everything. There are some religions that believe that God actually is everything. He's in everything. That chair is God. That tree is God. You and I are God. I would suggest to you, if you and I are God, we're not doing a very good job at it. But Jews and Christians have never believed that. God is everywhere, but he is not the same as the things that he created. He stands apart from his creation. If you reflect on the omnipresence of God, it communicates another comforting thing, that God is always with me. Jesus said, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. Behold, I am with you always. He is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. I got saved on my bed when I was 8 years old one night, and I will tell you that the beautiful presence of God came to me in that moment, and he has never left me since. 12 things Christians believe about God. God is eternal. God is a spirit. God is a person. God is omniscient, omnipresent, and God is omnipotent. That means he is all powerful. Oh, I wish you were here at the 5:30 service last night. When I got to this point in the sermon, I said, God is omnipotent. He is all powerful. And kaboom, a lightning bolt struck right next to the building, shook the whole house. We had about 30 people got saved last night in the 5:30 p.m. service. God is all powerful. He can do anything. And there is nothing which he cannot do. Sometimes people like to ask silly questions, like if God is all powerful, can he make a rock so big he couldn't lift it? Pastor Nick likes to say yes, and then he would lift it anyway. God's power is limitless. He made the heavens simply by speaking them into existence. The Bible says that with God, nothing is impossible. Once again, the truth that God is omnipotent is something that brings us great comfort. God's omnipotence means that no matter how much power he has expended, his power is not diminished in the least. Listen, if someone else got her miracle first, you never have to worry that God won't have enough power left to help you out. God doesn't need any downtime. He doesn't need to recharge. If he's performed one miracle, he can perform another one greater than that in the very next instant. There was a father that fell on his knees in front of Jesus pleading for the life of his daughter. But before Jesus could respond, a bleeding woman pushed her way through the crowd and touched Jesus and got her miracle. But that didn't mean that Jesus was done for the day. He still had plenty of power left to raise that father's daughter back to life again. Listen, don't you worry, don't you fret. Sometimes it can be a little discouraging when we've been praying and believing and waiting on God for a breakthrough and someone else gets their answer first. Don't you get discouraged. All that means is that your answer is next. It's on the way. God's omnipotence also means that anything is possible at any time. If you want to know how I'm making it through this building project, and how I made it through the first building project, it's that I literally, this is honestly the truth, I literally wake up every morning expecting that something miraculous is going to happen today. I literally wake up every day expecting that my answer to prayer is coming today. I walk to the mailbox believing that the check that's going to finish the building is going to be there in the mail. I'm telling you the truth. The phone rings, I believe that it's going to be good news. The email chimes, I believe it's going to be. I literally wake up every day believing something good is going to happen because anything is possible at any time. In fact, I didn't even tell the other services this, but I have a little different read on nothing is impossible with God. I know that on one level it means nothing is too difficult with God, but I like to take it this way. Nothing is impossible with God. In other words, if God is in it, it is impossible for nothing to happen. It is impossible for God to leave you alone. It's impossible for things to stay broken. It's impossible for things to stay where they're at. Nothing is impossible with God. If God is in it, it's got to get better. It's got to get fixed. It's got to get healed. It's got to have a transformation. It's not possible to wake up in the morning and have nothing happen that day. Not if God is in it. That's good. I'm preaching myself happy right now. I really am. I was teaching this to my students at the School of Acts in Kuala Lumpur, and in the morning session. And while I teach, the office staff at Pastor Raymond's church listen on closed circuit television. And so I was telling them, and it's true. I wake up every morning. I wake up believing something is going to happen today. So Pastor Raymond was listening in the office, and he was chuckling a little bit as I was telling this to the students. And so it came time for afternoon break, and for some reason he thought we all wanted ice cream, and so he took us way downtown to a shopping mall where there was an ice cream place. It was like one of those, you know, cafes that's like right in the middle of the mall, you know, you sit down and everybody's passing you on either side. And so we sat down and he found out none of us really wanted ice cream. We just wanted coffee. And he said, well, why did we come all the way down here? You know, we could have gone anywhere for coffee. Why did we come all the way here? And as we were sitting there in the middle of that shopping mall, a man walked by. Pastor Raymond had been held up for 3 or 4 years for a building permit to complete his church building. Malaysia is a Muslim-governed country, and it's illegal for churches, new churches, to own property or build buildings. You can't have a Bible school in Malaysia, but the Lord gave Pastor Raymond a 5-story building, and they needed permits to finish the building, and it had been held up for several years. And while we're sitting there in this little cafe in the middle of this shopping mall, the man in Kuala Lumpur who's in charge of issuing the permits walked by. And he noticed Pastor Raymond sitting there, and he went over and leaned over the rail and greeted him. And he said to him, come by at 5 p.m. tonight, and your permit will be ready. The omnipotence of God means that anything is possible at any time. We worship a God who is so powerful. Nothing is too hard for him. 12 things that Christians believe about God. Number 7, God is sovereign. Beloved, listen, this is precisely the point at which people wrestle with God. God's sovereignty means that his will is completely unfettered. God is the highest authority that exists. He is king of everything. God rules over any being that exists, and everything that lives is accountable and answerable to him. But it means even more than that. It means that God is the only one capable of doing whatever he wishes. Ultimately, God answers to no one. David said, for I know the Lord is great, and our Lord is above all gods. Whatever the Lord pleases, he does, in heaven and in earth, in the seas and in all the deep places. I want you to listen to this. Satan's downfall was a result of his direct challenge to God's sovereignty in heaven. And at the heart of his deception in the garden was a challenge to God's sovereignty. Has God really said? And then he defied God and said, you shall not surely die. And what is left in the heart of every man and every woman is a challenge to God's sovereignty. We bring God down to our level and we question him. We question his motives and his methods based on our finite understanding of how things work. This is the struggle that's at the heart of the book of Job. It's really at the heart of the Gospels as they invited Jesus to sit at a table with them and eat as an equal. They didn't sit at Jesus' feet like Mary did as a teacher to students listening and eager to learn. They sat at an equal plane with Jesus at a table and they weighed him with their questions. Imagine the Creator being weighed by his own creations. And they found him wanting. In fact, they found him worthy of the worst possible kind of death, the most ignominious kind of death. And we do the same thing. We bring God down to our level and we weigh him and we measure him and we cross-examine him based on our finite understanding of things. God said, psh, you think I was one such as yourself. 12 things Christians believe about God. Number 8, God is the creator. As Christians, we believe God is the creator of everything. We're going to talk more about creation in depth, but we believe that from nothing God made the heavens and the earth. He is what the philosophers call the first cause. Nothing caused God, but God caused everything. Again, God is not part of his creation. He stands apart from it. And he fashioned things with knowledge and wisdom. Listen, we are not the result of subatomic collisions or accidents in outer space. Creation had a definite beginning according to the plan of God. And it's important you know this. The universe is not meaningless. Your life is not meaningless. You were created intentionally by God. David said, I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows well. Beloved, somebody received this morning. This world, this universe, it's not an accident, and you are not an accident. Even if your parents told you you were an accident. Guess what? People make mistakes. God doesn't make any. Somebody, you received this. I didn't say this in any of the services, so this is for somebody in this service. In the name of Jesus, I tell you, you are not an accident. You are here by the express design and purpose of God. You are here because God willed you to be here. Thank you, Jesus. 12 things Christians believe about God. Number 9, God is holy. God is holy. Holiness is not popular these days, but it's important to know God is holy. Holiness means God is set apart from everyone and everything. He is different. There is no one like him. Moses said, "Who is like unto you, O Lord, among the gods?" To say God is holy also means that he is morally pure and perfect. God cannot do evil, nor can he be tempted to do anything evil. Everything God does is righteous. You listen to me, even if it doesn't make sense to you, everything he does is righteous. Everything he does is completely fair and just. His character is noble, selfless, and spotless. Habakkuk said, "You are of purer eyes than to behold evil. You cannot look on wickedness." The Bible says that God is a consuming fire. He lives in unapproachable light. No man has ever seen the full manifestation of the glory of God and lived to tell about it. Even the seraphim who surround the throne room of God and constantly cry, "Holy, holy, holy," have to cover their eyes with their wings, for they are not permitted to look on the full manifestation of God. But you know, one day we're going to have a revelation of God that is different than anything else in creation has ever had. The Bible says this is why the devil hates us so much. What he tried to gain through improper means, God is going to do for us. It's what we're destined for. One day we are destined to see God as he is. One day we are destined to see a revelation of the full manifestation of God's glory that nothing else in creation has ever seen. And when we see, the Bible says the angels long to look into these things and understand them. And when we see him, we shall become like him, for we shall see him as he is. That brings us to number 10, which is God wants a relationship with us. The Bible shows us that God desires the companionship of people, even in our messed up condition. We're made in his image, which means many different things, but one thing it certainly means is that we have the ability to communicate with him and relate to him. Isn't it amazing that God should be interested in us at all? I mean, really, if you can make galaxies, are people really all that interesting? But the Bible tells us that God is in fact interested in us, so much that he wants to have a relationship, a love relationship with us. David said, "When I consider the heavens, the work of your hands, what is man that you're mindful of him, yet you love him and visit him?" That leads us to number 11. God has revealed himself to us. We're on the home stretch now. We're almost done. As someone once said, God is there and he is not silent. God has spoken to us since the beginning of history, and as time went on, he revealed more and more of himself to us. As Christians, we believe God has revealed himself to us in three different ways. First of all, creation reveals the existence of God. God has programmed it into our human heart that when we look at the beauty and the order and the magnitude of creation, there is something in our heart that says there must be a God. Creation doesn't tell us how to know God, but it tells our heart that there is a God. Can I tell you, we can explain scientifically what causes a rainbow to appear in the sky. We can't explain scientifically what makes us pull our car off the side of the road and snap pictures of it every time we see one. We can't explain what the emotion that a sunrise or a sunset or a magnificent landscape evokes in our heart. God has programmed our heart in such a way that when we look at creation, something inside us tells us that something greater, someone greater than us, made it all. The Bible reveals to us the nature of God. We talked about the Bible last week, and let me just say, it's important that we digest the whole Bible so we have a complete picture of God. You know, there's an Eastern folktale about a group of blind men that all came across an elephant. And each one of the blind men grabbed onto a different part of the elephant. One grabbed onto the tail. One grabbed onto a leg. One grabbed onto the belly. One grabbed onto the trunk. And each one of them was insisting, "The elephant is like this. The elephant is like this. The elephant is like this." They were all wrong because none of them had the whole picture. And if we don't read the whole Bible, we won't have a complete picture of God. Beloved, listen to me. There are some parts of the Bible that taste sweet in your mouth like honey. There are other parts of the Bible that are like vinegar in your stomach. They'll leave you a little bit uncomfortable, but we need the whole counsel of God. Jesus reveals God to us in a unique way. Christians believe that God's greatest and most unique revelation of himself is Jesus Christ. God became a man in the person of Jesus. And now we can not only read about what God is like, but we can encounter him in real life. Jesus said, "If you have seen me, you have seen the Father." Jesus represents God to us in a way that mere words could never do, no matter how special those words are. He's God in the flesh. And that brings us to number 12. 12 things that Christians believe about God. God is eternal. God is a spirit. God is a person. He's omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent. He's sovereign. God is the creator. God is holy. God desires a relationship with us. God has revealed himself to us. And number 12, you ready for it? God is love. God not only has love, God is love. It is the very essence of his nature and being. That means God is good. He's benevolent. He wishes people well and not harm. He's not like the gods of other religions who are distant and unknowable, or as one religion even calls their God, the greatest of all deceivers. He's not uncaring about our situation. The Christmas angels announced peace on earth and goodwill to all men. God is motivated by selfless love, which thinks about the good of others, namely you. He wants the very best for you. He wants everything in your life to work together for your ultimate good. Now listen, that doesn't mean you'll understand every twist and turn in your life, but it does mean that God genuinely loves you and cares about you. To that end, the Bible makes a remarkable claim that God, who made the universe, actually loved us so much that he became one of us in order to remove the barriers between us so that we could be with him forever. I love that new song we're learning right now. What a beautiful name it is. We're going to sing it together at the Palace Theater on Good Friday. I hope you'll be there to worship with us. In fact, we need you to join the Good Friday choir for our great service at the Palace Theater. If you can sing, we need you to join the choir. Now listen, if you can't sing but you look good, we want you to join the choir and we'll just put you up there. You can just move your mouth, all right? Your voice, Pastor Jason. Your voice. We'll stand you next to Dom and they'll think that his voice is your voice, okay? No, I'm just kidding. But there's one lyric in that little song that I love so much. It says, "You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven near." Think about it. The infinite, eternal, amazing God who lives in unapproachable light. He wanted us so much that he refused to spend eternity in heaven without us. So he sent Jesus to come to our rescue. That's the story of God in one little stanza. Who is like unto you, O Lord, among the gods? You are glorious in holiness. You are fearful in praises, and you do mighty wonders. Would you stand on your feet and give a great big praise to the God, the King of the universe?